We started to discuss yesterday holonomies as one basic set of variables, and they were there to parallel transport vectors around, vectors with an internal index along a curve. And so this was defined to be the parallel transported vector. Now I already use here this idea that V without an index is actually Vj times Tj. So it's a bit, I could use an extra letter, but it's a bit hard to put everything in boldface on the blackboard. And so this was the equation. And so we need to define, you know, what is parallel transport? What does it mean? What is the condition for parallel transporting a vector? Indeed. So it's covariant. So what we want is that the derivative of gamma is a curve of, actually now we are in the spatial manifold of this vector actually vanishes. Since we defined Vs, this is actually equal to the derivative of this vector with respect to S. So we need to remember this covariant derivative. And so we had this a few lectures ago. This was partial derivative. Some components now, this is partial derivative. And then we had this epsilon. So connection, which at back then was called omega, but now it's called A, so it's the same thing, just that it's all on the spatial hypersurface. VL. And so we can actually rewrite this equation using our Lie algebra valued forms, and then it looks much more elegant, depending on your notion of elegance. And so I take the partial, I take the covariant derivative of this vector valued form. And so this is really just understood that I take this, what I've now tried to find is this object multiplied with Tj or the other way, or the other way around. So I get rid of that. And it takes the partial derivative of this vector. And again, this is just understood as taking the components, the partial derivative of the components, and multiplying the result with Pj again, which is this matrix. And so here, I basically write use the commutator of the algebra, which is given by an epsilon, and just write that as the commutator of my Lie algebra valued connection and the Lie algebra valued vector. So if you use just epsilon j t l t j, and you remain with the components, you will find the previous result again. AVL. So you see that these things are the same. So we can now write basically the covariant derivative in this form. And so to write it in this form, you can also all the gauge theories in the standard model or beyond standard models. The covariant derivatives plays a big role there. So you have to be a bit careful. So this term changes if you change the representation in which this transforms. So this is really the joint representation. Then you have this commutator. Yes?
So I'm kind of getting confused between vectors like in the adjoint representation and vectors on the manifold. So like, is V a scalar on the manifold, or is it a?
V is a scalar, apparently. Yeah, V is a scalar. So it's a scalar on the manifold, but has one internal index. Okay. So let's take that away. That was just. Okay, so we demand that this thing should be actually zero. So my spatial indices are now these little Latin indices, and the internal indices are the from the beginning of the alphabet, and the internal ones are I, J, K, and so on. And so here I use basically my definition of V as HS V0 HS minus 1. So basically this is given by the differential of VS. So I actually get a differential on these things. And then basically a differential on these terms. These terms. So this would be just these two terms, and now I add and subtract two terms. I add and subtract one term. And just write it in a different order. Oh, let me. Actually, the commutator. This is a So this is not because this is a commutator of these terms. And comes from these things. So these are these commutator terms. So in fact, this comes from the partial derivative, and these other terms come from the covariant derivative terms here. Thank you. So we see that this term, if this term is equal to this term, then this term vanishes, and likewise, HSV, this term has to be equal to this term. And so this is the inverse, this is the inverse derivative which you can write in terms of the usual derivative by using this trick. And you will get a minus sign, and that takes care of this minus sign. And so the condition you get is that this has to be equal to minus gamma dot A. So the connection at the point S, so this is the connection now written in as a, at a spatial point, depending on the point S. And then we have HS here. And then we have another condition, namely that H0 is equal to the identity matrix. Okay. So these, maybe write them this way. So indeed, this is kind of a definition. I have to be. So we have this condition, and this is the defining differential equation for our holonomy. It's a first order differential equation. It has an initial value, which is it should be equal to 1. So there will be a unique solution, and it looks a bit complicated, but in a sense, it's just the standard first order differential equation, which tells me that H dot is H, and such a differential equation has a solution, which is just the exponential. So we expect basically that this will be related to some exponential. And so the, you know, so here you have kind of a this thing, gamma dot A. But these coefficients are path dependent. So you need to actually integrate them in the exponential. So you get an integral. And then there's a further difficulty, namely that these things, this thing is a matrix. And these matrices don't commute along your way. So what you get is a path ordered exponential. So that's what so what we get. So if you write this again, the differential equation, for instance, and I think you have this tutorial or homework or something where you have to confirm that in great detail. So you integrate this once, and then as you do actually for time-dependent perturbation theory in quantum mechanics, and then you get an integral equation. And this integral equation is given by 1, which comes from using this initial value, minus 0s gamma a. So here you take this thing. And here I forgot a dot. My script. And yours. ES prime. And so you have this integral equation, which is equivalent to this differential equation. And so now you use the same trick in iterating. And using this solution inside here, and so one finds basically modulo this minus sign, the fast ordered exponential. So this is defined to be the fast ordered differential. And then I write this funny expression, because if I want to go without any indices, then this is a one form. And I can integrate the one form along gamma, and then it's all pass ordered. And so here I write you the definition of this thing. And I hope you have seen the pass ordered exponential in quantum mechanics. You get the minus n from the minus sign. Then you have lots of integrals. P s n minus 1. And the only difference, and depending on conventions, is whether you order from left to the right or from right to the left. Just let me finish these last two things. And so that's the formula here. That's the definition of the pass order differential. Yeah.
So you say we're taking this as a definition of the path order exponential. Uh-huh. However, if I take an expansion of the exponential, there are numerical factors, right?
Uh-huh.
There are like 1 over n factorial.
Yeah. So, yeah.
So the question is if the path ordering operator itself is a linear operator or not.
Yeah, no, it's
because the only way that I can recover those numerical factors.
No, I mean the answer, so the numerical factors, they are actually there, but they are absorbed in how these boundaries are defined.
Sure.
You understand this, okay.
So the thing is that if I want to change the limits of integration to be not to be nested, but just to be from 0 to the same one.
Right? Yeah.
That then only works if my integrand is symmetric, right?
Yeah, then you get 1 over n faculty.
OK.
So it's really that you, so this 1 over n factorial,
sure.
is absorbed by choosing, by not integrating over a square, but over the triangle or something. Okay. So that's comes in. So this is and so this is linear operator. I'm a bit confused what you mean. So it's not linear in A, but the entire object is a holonomy.
Right.
Will be a linear operator in quantum mechanics, but a quantum field theory on our quantization. But I don't think that's what you mean. So
no. What I meant is just if I have the path ordering of the exponential. Uh-huh. If I make the series of the exponential, does the path ordering distributes over that sum? So that I have the sum of path ordered product?
Yeah. It's basically because every term here is parse ordered.
Right.
Okay. So that's, you know, so every term here, I mean, this is the sum over these terms.
Sure.
And every term here, this S is later than, I hope, yeah. So this S is always later than this S and so on. So it just defined to be this sum.
Okay.
And the 1 over n faculty comes from integrating over, I don't know what these things are called for higher dimensions.
Yeah.
Generalized triangles instead of cubes, squares. And so indeed, you could see that you get to this sum structure by putting this term again here, and you get an iterated integral. And so you get one term from the one, which is just one integral, but another from this term, and this would be a double integral, and so on. And you get this parse order, because here you integrate over 0 s, and then you integrate. You get this parse ordering because here you have S prime, and in the next term you only go up to S prime, basically. Okay. So that's this parse ordered exponential, and actually this is always the solution, so it always comes again and again in physics. Always if you have this kind of differential equation, where you have, you know, it's a linear differential equation. You have a differential of something equal this object, but it's multiplied with some time-dependent factor. And so this is just a very general thing. And we actually have just written the general solution to that. Okay. And so for closed loops, for closed gamma, so these objects will still transform for closed gamma, because then they you know, still have this transformation that if this is s equal to 0, are transformed now under the adjoint action, where of course I don't remember where the minus one is, but this is so it's not so these closed holonomies, if you are in a non-abelian group, they're not gauge invariant yet. If you take the trace, then they're gauge invariant. And in any case, these objects are quite often called Wilson loops. And so these are the basic things which you use in lattice gauge theory. okay. So these are the holonomies, and this will be our basic, one set of our basic variables, and we smeared them over one-dimensional objects. And so we have another set of variables. Which are called the fluxes. And from yesterday, 2 days ago, or yeah, I explained that we expect in 2 plus 1 to integrate the fluxes over one-dimensional objects. Because the holonomies are smeared over one-dimensional objects. We have a 2D-dimensional spatial manifold. So if we compute the Poisson brackets between these smeared basic variables, we expect that on the right-hand side, we don't need an integration, but we also don't get any delta function thingy. And so this will be confirmed, and we will find a beautiful Poisson algebra, but we need to work to to figure this Poisson algebra out. So we go on and define the fluxes, and these come from the these variables called also fluxes. And originally we had this was defined the opposite way from the connection. So there was an index there and there. I had it here. And so actually now we go back to our co-triads, which were one forms, because we can integrate one forms. And we can also do everything with these triads in this Lie algebra valued form, saving an index and writing these things as actually matrices. And so this was defined to be this 2D Levi-Civita EB JTJ. And so we would like to smear these objects over one dimensional curve. And so this curve will be called gamma star for some reason. Because later it will basically cut gamma. I think gamma, yeah. So, and okay. Technically, it will be always this way to be orientation wise. So this gamma and gamma star are positively oriented, but you will only need that sometimes. So we have these as one forms. We would like to integrate them. However, so we would like to sum these vectors along this curve. However, a priori, all these vectors live in different frames. So what we actually have to do is to parallel transport them all to the same frame. And this frame will be in my definition. So you can, so there's again lots of different definitions. So what we are going to do is to parallel transport these co-triads all back to this point, which is the starting point of gamma. So since here I have a kindergarten choice of colors, and we are doing that. So for 1 plus 1D, it's nice because there's a canonical choice of how to do that. So we're going to do that if you are here, you go here, and you go here, and so on. And so if you're going here, you do this. So you define this parallel transport. And to parallel transport, you go first to the intersection point and then back to the starting point of gamma. And so this parallel transport will be called H gamma star. And so there is a, now there is basically this parameter S, which actually is the parameter parametrizing this curve, gamma star. And so this will be the parallel transport. Let me check from where to where it is. From gamma star S, so it's really actually in this direction, the blue curves, to gamma zero. Okay, so we use this to parallel transport our connection, and then we define variables which, okay, are also labeled by gamma for to save the star. And so these will be integrals over gamma star. And here is my parallel transport. Here is the actual co-triad. so it's Lie algebra valued at the point gamma star s. So this integration over one form abstractly means that if we have this one index, it's actually contracted with gamma dot. Gamma dot is with respect to this parameter s. And gamma dot has a vector, and it's contracted with this cotriad. And so these are just numbers. And here, however, there's still these generators T, which are matrices. And this is multiplied with this matrix. And from the right, you have the inverse matrix. So this is gamma, gamma star S minus 1 ds. And so this is the definition of the flux operator. And we will see later why we actually choose the dual curve here. so why we choose the fluxes to smear along these curves. And we will also have later a geometrical interpretation of this flux variable in our quantum theory. But I can tell you, so these were these triads or co-triads, which were giving us a frame, and actually we could construct the matrix out of it. And so indeed, this will give us actually the expression of the vector associated to this curve, gamma star, in this frame associated to this vertex. So it will be basically an edge vector in the end. And you get that via basically adding up all these co-triads along this curve. Okay. So you can understand that, that this is basically the difference between these two co-triads in the end, between sitting here and sitting here, and that gives you the vector of this edge. Yeah.
Why is that gamma dot A and not gamma dot star A?
Oh, yeah, it should be gamma dot star A. Thanks. Okay. So sometimes they are called simplicial fluxes. But this is only if you know the other fluxes. So now the nice thing about using this formula, so there's you might think it's a slight disadvantage because you see that these objects seem to be quite complicated. Because they're not just combinations of our basic variables EA, but they involve the holonomies. So you might be afraid that you get a very complicated constraint algebra. And so indeed, an usual loop quantum gravity, you have similar fluxes. So in 3 plus 1, it's the same formula. It's not the same formula, but it's a very similar formula, just over surfaces. But typically, you don't use the parallel transport. Then it turns out that nevertheless you get the same algebra of these observables, and in practice they also transform the same way. So to actually explain this, it's a bit safer to just start from the beginning with these parallel transported fluxes, and then you actually know that these fluxes, they live in a frame. And so under gauge transformation, they transform under the gauge transformation at this point. So under gauge transformation, because now you transported everything to this frame. And so you can go indeed to this formula and apply each for each object here the rule for gauge transformation. you will find that this flux E gamma transforms another gauge transformation of the source node of your curve gamma. Okay. And then with our definitions of Faraday transports, it actually happens that you can change the orientation of an edge. And so if you do that, not very surprisingly, the holonomy associated to the inverse of an edge is the inverse of the holonomy of this edge. And so for the flux, you have the inverse. And so I told you this is a vector from here to here. So if you invert, this edge, you have also to invert this edge. So you find in principle minus this vector. However, if you invert this edge, you also change the source node from here to here. So you have to parallel transport your flux, the gamma, to the endpoint of gamma. And so this is a formula that accomplishes this. So basically, the picture which we get is that we have curve gamma, frames it at the starting points of gamma, and then we have our dual curves, gamma prime, and so later on, you know, we will form a network, and this looks like a triangle. There are different terms, curves, gamma prime, and actually I should have done this. And so you will have frames, and actually here you have another frame prime, and so you will have frames sitting inside these triangles. And so what you do is to express with these fluxes all these edge vectors of the triangles in a given frame. Okay. And now there is a slightly horrible calculation. Which is to compute the Poisson brackets. Between our basic variables. And so this you can do also to, using a different amount of mathematical rigor. So in principle, you could say, I smear them over three-dimensional things, and then compute this because of my delta functions in my basic variables, the field variables. But in fact, we will do a slightly shortcutted calculation and actually just take these objects, so the holonomies and the fluxes smeared over one-dimensional objects. And do this computation. And so you, so the most complicated thing in the end you can imagine is this between two fluxes, because now the fluxes also have these holonomies, and the only thing which does not commute in the continuum are the Poisson brackets between connection and the triads. So you might think that you get something very complicated here. Indeed, there will be a trick to do this calculation, but one can also do this calculation. So the easier part is the Poisson brackets between holonomies. which will be zero, because holonomies are just functions or functionals of the connection, and the connection commutes. So we managed 1/3 of our task. Here I've written something bad. Let me check what kind of notation I use. So the Poisson brackets here to be understood between the matrix elements of the holonomies. And so for matrix elements, I think I use capital letters. No, I use, okay, I can write MN. So this was easy. Now comes the more complicated part. Between holonomy and flux. Okay, so we have to first write our fluxes. Again, in a more manageable form, and one problem is that in the Poisson brackets, you know, we cannot have matrices in both entries, because then it's a bit unclear how to order these matrices. So we can have a matrix in one of the entries, and in the others it should be a kind of number or function. And so that's why I actually wrote here the matrix components, because it's a bit unclear if you write two matrices what it means. And so we can extract actually from our Lie algebra valued flux again the components. And so there's just actually the simple formula, the trace of your Lie algebra valued flux with Tj. Because basically this trace on this Lie algebra gives you an inner product. It's called the Killing form. And so you can compute if you put for t again the Pauli spin matrix, this is -1/2 dgk, and because of this -1/2, you have -2 here. And so we are going to do this and need to express this object. From this object, we need to again express actually our flux components E, A, J here, so that we can compute the Poisson brackets. And so if you do that, we just write this same formula. We get the -2 trace Tj. This is the same Tj. So the order does not matter here. Because inside the trace, you can commute two matrices. And so I write all this holonomy transports and so on. So then I write here Tk. And I would write basically the component EAK here, but this would be just a component inside the trace, and I will write that later. So then I just have gamma star here as -1. So everything which is a matrix, I write inside this trace. And so here I write my co-triad component. And so I write it immediately in the form with my original flux variables, bk. ds. So now I managed to isolate actually my flux components, so these flux components, from the rest. And so I will call all this rest something with an index fjk s, and then I have this epsilon ba gamma star gamma dot star a s my flux. Okay, so basically minus 2 the trace is defines me this expression fjk. And these fjk come from these indices. And so indeed what we now have is because I made this choice of how gamma and gamma star are defined. Well, let me first say that I consider basically exactly the situation that I have two curves, gamma and gamma star, and so they intersect each other. So I think this was gamma, this was gamma star. And so they have here this intersection point, which I put at, you know, in all kinds of parametrizations at s being equal 1/2. And so I expect that I will only find something from this intersection point in Poisson brackets, because that's where actually the holonomy and the connection and the triad meet each other. Poisson brackets have this delta function. So I split h gamma into h gamma. Okay, one because for some reason goes backwards. Where I defined actually h gamma now with two indices s prime prime s prime, and it's a holonomy from s prime to s prime 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 along gamma. And so here I can make epsilon, so this will be the important part. And I can make epsilon arbitrarily small, because again, I just have the Dirac delta here. And so we will approximate this thing. to linear approximation. Linear order in epsilon, and it's linear because epsilon appears in this integration boundaries. And so here I only need, basically from my path ordered exponential, I will only need this linear term. And I will have higher order terms in epsilon. Okay, and then I've just again written explicitly the Lie algebra element here and my original connection here. And now we are almost there. So now we can actually take everything into one for some bracket by using this expression and this expression. And so the only annoying thing is that it's a lengthy expression with lots of annoying things, but I try to write everything already as compact as possible. So we have this E gamma J H gamma. And so we have this identity matrix. No, the identity matrix is of no interest at all. It will drop out in the end. And here we have an expression which is proportional to this Lie algebra TL. So this is just a constant. I can take out, can take that out of the integral. And and then we have in this H gamma our we have split it into three parts. And so the middle part comes with this matrix valued T. So the matrix valued thing is TL. So I will just actually write this times TL times this. And then have the scalar value, which is given by this integral. And for some reason, I have a minus sign. Which I don't know yet where it comes from. So this is basically all the matrices which appear in my expression, and now I have my integrals. So I have an integral over gamma star. I have this integral over gamma. And so for the integral over gamma star, I had this coefficients fjk as I had actually my flux variable ba gamma star as. Here comes, this is gamma dot c, so this comes from the holonomy. This is s prime. And here come actually the Poisson brackets, so I have e bk there, gamma star s, al. And here comes the connection. And so I integrate ds over ds and ds prime, and I have an epsilon squared term. And the minus sign comes from this minus sign. Okay, but now it's basically easy. So here I would get the, here I forgot the delta, the Poisson bracket. So here I have my Poisson brackets. And so we know that this gives us a delta function between these points. So this is a dual star gamma s prime delta bc delta cl. However, I have here, you know, a delta function of where gamma star dot and gamma dot, no, gamma star and gamma appear. But the integral is over S parameters. and this is also it's a 2D delta function. so if I have these delta functions, it's like delta F. Yeah, delta Fx. And then there's a formula for that, which I completely forgot. Can rewrite it as delta x, but we have to. I hope you. It's this way. If I remember correctly, so we have to divide by this derivative, and in higher dimensions, what we actually get is a Jacobian transformation. so it's, but this Jacobian, you know, Jacobian is a determinant, and it's we speak of a 2x2 matrix, and so this gives you actually the Jacobian here, and also because of our definitions, this is actually of orientation. This is actually bigger than zero, if I haven't done anything wrong. So there's something wrong in the indices.
The delta function takes care of it.
Sorry?
Were the indices right? Just the delta function takes care of the delta VC.
Okay, that's, there are too many Cs.
Should be epsilon VA. Gamma
B. Ah, so I didn't, yeah, so sorry. So this was correct, B, A. But then B becomes a C.
Yeah.
And then you get the delta function, the determinant here. You get to your Jacobian. And so in the end, you get this still to be delta KL. And so this will be delta, basically just the delta functions in S. And I need only 2 minutes. And I think I have to make one remark, namely that we have here this Levi-Civita thing appearing. So assume you would have considered two curves which are parallel to each other. So that gamma and gamma star are actually parallel to each other. And also it's something with E and holonomy. And you would expect a very complicated result. You get actually zero. Because then you get zero from this expression. So you don't get anything if two curves are tangent to each other. You only get something if they are transversal to each other. But the angle doesn't matter. So it's, you know, because we have this Jacobian automatically inside. So we get the same result no matter how the two curves cut each other. They just need to cut each other. So the only thing where you get zero is if they're really tangent to each other. And so here you see this topological feature. So we indeed find that for the Poisson bracket, our great result which is actually almost the final result, but not completely. So we have H gamma 1. So this comes all from there. And here, if somebody said there's a minus here, which kills this minus there. So this is all in the first line, h comma 1/2, 0. So then all these things are just being my delta functions, which are integrated. And kl is just an index. Which acts then on this delta kl acts on this f. So here I have f gl 1/2. And so now I just need to express fg, to look at fgl 1/2, which is this here. And actually, I think I will pick it up tomorrow. I can write here the result that h gamma tj, that this thing, so it says these parallel transports along these complicated parallel transports in blue here along s, but now we go actually always to the intersection point. So these are h gamma, gamma star will simplify to be just over parallel transports over h gamma. And so they will be similar to these things. And that's the reason why, you know, this term gets actually cancelled. And in the end, we will find an h gamma just to the left-hand side. And so we will fix that up tomorrow. And this will already give us our basic Poisson bracket, which will be this one. And you could have expected it because the holonomies are exponentials of the connection. And so if you did takes the derivative of the exponential, you get again an exponential. And so we only get our holonomy multiplied with this matrix Tj. OK. So let's do this tomorrow. And actually then, I'm not computing the fluxes, but we will have a simple argument to get the Poisson brackets between the fluxes. And this will give us our extremely nice algebra in the end. Okay, thank you.